Okay, these lights are telling because it's all based blue. And we don't have blue on our projector. So the yellow you see is actually green. The screenshots will look a little bit strange, but I think we can live with that. When Fosdem contacted me some time ago, they asked about a talk, not about KDE, but a talk about KDE future, which is a difficult thing to do, because the future is blurry. But I'll try nevertheless. Here's the agenda for the next like 45-50 minutes. I will talk about the original goals of the KDE project, give a short history of the Unix desktop, really just a brief and short history. Then I talk about the present. Now when I talk about the present of KDE, I will not talk about the code that we have today, but about the challenges that the project is facing today. In other words, the things we are working on today. That means immediate challenges and opportunities, strategic key focus areas, technical challenges, usability challenges, challenges from the programming framework's perspective, social challenges for the project itself and the sustainability of the project. I think that's enough challenges. Then I will try to, if I still have time, to look ahead, what has changed and what does the future bring. To give me some kind of input or hint to whom I'm talking to. I mean, most of you are software engineers that I understand. But are there any people who have written like graphical user interface application for the free desktop? If you've written like GUI stuff, could you raise your hands, please? Okay, that's like 15%. Thank you. So that's still a lot. The others, is it like, I mean, I assume you like GUIs and you're interested in GUIs, that's why you're here tonight, this morning. So there's still a lot of potential. Let's start with the original goals. KDE was one of the first projects, I think, on the desktop that targeted both developers and users alike. Because our goal was twofold and right from the start. For the users, we wanted to provide a consistent user experience. For the developers, we wanted to give them a better development experience. Because what does that mean and how can you achieve both goals at the same time? If you just think about the users and you say, things should be consistent and easy and user-friendly, you can set up lots of guidelines and say, an application should do this, 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 and that. And then you enforce those guidelines by forcing the developers to write the applications like that. Now, good luck. Free software developers that do voluntary work will not just do the things because you tell them to. So the idea we had was, we would make it really easy for the developer to write standard-compliant applications. And by that, by providing a development framework, we would give the users a consistent user experience. Now, what does development experience mean? Ultimately, the ultimate goal for a development framework is to let developers focus on the real task of the software and not all the other stuff, not all the new stuff that you have to do in addition. Now what does that mean, all the other stuff? Should have waited a little bit more. Good morning. Now what is the other stuff that people have to do? If you go back a little time, I don't know, some of you have written applications for Linux like 10 years ago, like the early KDE people did. If you did that, writing an end-user application and really going the last mile to make it usable was painful. It was really painful. Like you had to, in the small print you see some examples, you had to write a configuration file parser. You had to write your online help system. You had to write a couple of standard widgets because they were not all there. You had to invent the file dialog, the print dialog, your own PostScript driver, because there was no way, no common way to do printing. You had to draw yourself standard icons because there were none. You probably invented your build system and some drag and drop protocol, and. In the end, when you wanted to write a small application, you would spend more time and more code and more energy in doing stuff that you really didn't want to do. The result was that that stuff, of course, wasn't as good as it should be. The second important part of a development experience is to share components with others. Now, why is that important? It's important because it improves your components. If you write a component in your application that is also used for other kinds of applications, and you give that, you make that available to those developers before where they can use it, they will actually improve the component, they will give you feedback. It's a very rewarding thing. But what's even better is that they will allow you to share their components, so it will improve your application. If you look at, and we've been very successful with that approach, if you look at many of the smaller KDE applications, the amount of code that they are based on is a lot more than the amount of code that the application itself is. So most of the functionality, even for the small tools, comes from shared components written by other people. And the prime example is the KDevelop IDE. I don't know who of you has seen the presentation from Harald Frohnagel yesterday. It's a prime example of what you can achieve by putting components together and making them work. A little bit of history, it won't be too much. Can you actually see that screen, or is it too light in here? '95, there was still a common desktop to start with when you came to Unix or GNU Linux systems. I don't know who of you used that kind of desktop. That was how I started at the university, and that was what people used. So what do we see here? We have all the core elements of a modern desktop. We have, start with the most important thing. We do have a clock. We still have that on desktops today. We have nifty background utilities that inform us about the CPU load. So when the system became slow, you would see on this graphical display that your system became slow. That was an important application, XMAT. It was a man page viewer, an interactive man page viewer. It had a great feature, if you look at the window down here, that it had like a rich text rendering. You see some of the like X, it's bold, so it looks very nice on the italic font. Actually, I don't think anybody ever used XMAT because it was faster to just type man on the console. We had iCandy. X-Eyes. I don't know if you still remember that utility. The eyes would look at the position where the mouse cursor is. So you move the mouse cursor, the eyes would move. We had an editor, a graphical editor, this one you call X-Edit. And some of you may laugh, but I've actually seen people studying computer science programming with X-Edit, because that's what they found on the system until they finally learned Unix or Java. But the most important part of the desktop experience was the terminal. So X Windows, in a way, for the X Windows system, was a way to run many terminals, and we actually liked the system a lot because we could have, well, SSE overlapping windows, lots of terminals, multitasking. So it was perfect. We were actually, I think most of us were pretty happy with the system. Progress, of course, was unstoppable. And a few years later, in 1996, that was expanded desktop. Probably a lot of people remember that. So let's have a look at the innovations. We have a virtual desktop pager up here that allows us to switch desktops. The clock is shank, it's round. It used to be shank window extension. We do have very important a background image and a panel to start applications from. You see an interesting bit of technology, a little X node utility that showed you the CPU load is now embedded into the panel with an X repaired window. So that was really cool. We have some graphical applications. There's XV, which was the standard image viewer, and a little image manipulation. It still has the best key bindings of any image viewer that is out there. So if you want to clone it, please do it now. And we have the web, Netscape, standard web browser. I think this is Netscape, probably 2.something, using Motif. That's an original screenshot from 1996 where somebody wanted to show, like, look how cool my desktop is. You see they were hiding the real meat here. Here's an external, and here's an external. This is where the work was actually happening. And if you look at those companies here, I'm fairly sure that IRC would just launch external-e IRC, and that would probably, the news thing is probably external-e, I don't know, RN. What is interesting about that desktop is, in 96, that many of the most used graphical applications, XV and Netscape, were not FreeSocket. XV was shareware, although I think nobody bought a license ever. We did at some point. It took the XV author like 1 year to reply, and he said eventually thank you, and I removed the unregistered from the catalog. So it wasn't really a business, but it was shareware. Netscape was closed source. It was using a toolkit that didn't have runtime that it could distribute freely, and it was a closed source. But there was also a commercial world that we, and many people in the Linux community, or some people argue, we should go into the direction of becoming more like a real Unix. So that is the standard CVE desktop on Solaris. That is still kind of state of the art. If you buy a modern Solaris workstation today with Solaris 9, that is what you get. You can choose between an other version of GNOME. Or this one, I think this one is still the default. So that's what people use. I don't know, if some of you have not had the chance to use the CD desktop and play around with it, if you see a Sun workstation, do it. It's really an experience. It's so unbelievably sucky. And let me explain why. I mean, apart from being ugly, which is a matter of taste, there is the depth of the desktop is just like the depth of this desktop is very, very low. Like, you have beautiful icons here, but when you actually invoke them, you wouldn't get much. Let's make a step ahead. This is what we have today. Of course, my talk has a kicking. There's other systems you do know about. This is a KDE desktop. It still has a lot of elements of CDE or of the previous desktops. Like, you have the clock node there. I'm sorry for the colors, but this is not my laptop. That's the projector. You have a clock down there. You still have a virtual desktop switcher. You have a desktop, you have icons on the desktop, you have a file manager that looks, on the first glance, similar to CDE. But the real innovation, why that is different than what we had before, is what you have behind the icons. This here is not just a clock. If you click on it, you will get a calendar. This is not just a little icon that tells you, bing, you got an email, if you click on it, you get a full-featured groupware and calendaring and organizing application. These here is a help system, a word processing application, a complete mail application, a complete web browser, and all those icons represent a totally free, standard-compliant application that you can launch that didn't exist before. And the greatest feature of that desktop is, of course, the little cane menu, because when you open it, you have access to literally hundreds of applications written for that framework. So that is where the real progress is. Always keep in mind that KDE is a development framework, not just a way to launch applications. Many people badmouth the Linux desktop or the free desktop and say, oh, it's not ready, it will never be ready, it can never work. And they did that 5 years ago, and they will probably do that in 5 years from now. But if you look from it from a broader perspective, from the grand scheme of things, we were like just a few years ago than where we are today. If you would take today's free desktop and you move it a few years back, they would just totally rock and blow people away. We have productivity applications that are integrated with desktop like OpenOffice. We have web clients, not just one, we have several. We have Firefox and Chrome, free ones, we have Opera, which is a commercial browser. We have collaboration software, groupware stuff, content and evolution. We have a lot of things in the area of multimedia. Small programs, edutainment. If you want to teach kids to do useful stuff with computers rather than playing online games, there's a lot of software that you find on Linux that you can use for that. But the most important thing is it's a superb development platform. In many ways, it's a better platform to develop software for than anything else. Sometimes it's looking what we have achieved, and I mean the entire free desktop community in the past years, is pretty amazing by all the criticism that we sometimes get and that we do ourselves. Like, as late as in 1997, if you would demonstrate to an audience drag and drop, like dragging something on a panel or applications, the audience would be amazed. Wow, that's cool. Today, people are really annoyed that they cannot drag and drop between two applications. And that is progress. One of the things, or the jewels, I think, that made Linux a superb development platform is let me do that shameless plot. Qt. I'm bringing that up because that is the thing I'm working with the past couple of years. I think that is what I consider my, in the past year's, biggest contribution to the free desktop and the Linux in general. What is Qt? I don't know if anybody here used a program with it. It's a single source cross-platform C++ GUI toolkit. Now that's a lot of words. And essentially it means you can write one program, you compile it on different platforms, like Unix and Linux, Microsoft Windows, or Mac OS X or embedded Linux, and you just get a native, fast, native level feeling application on all those platforms. That's the basic thing. Qt is a lot more than just user interface classes. We cover I/O, printing, networking, XML, SQL drivers, different databases. We have process handling. We have classes for threading and more. So it's a couple of hundred classes. It's a fairly sophisticated framework. I don't know if you've read the announcement. Starting with version 4, that's the thing we're working on today. We will make it, we'll finally have it GPL across all platforms. That means you can write a GPL program, distribute it under the GPL with GPL Q on all these mentioned platforms, Linux, Windows, Mac, and embedded systems, which I think is pretty cool. To give you one of the, for those not working in toolkits, it's probably the same with other pieces of software. A toolkit seems like a very simple thing. Like a few widgets, how hard can it be? So many programmers start their own toolkits, and I think anybody who works in Trolltech, at least the first 20 people, have their own toolkit at some point in time. But once you do it more deeply, the devil's always in the detail. And writing toolkits becomes a more and more difficult task as time goes by, because people's expectation rise dramatically. To give you one key figure, just in the upgrade from Qt3 to Qt4, I think we invested something like, I haven't exact measurements, but roughly maybe 60 to 70 man years development. And one last number about Qt. If you wonder about the commercial impact of it, we have currently around 5,000 customers. Some of those have been companies with hundreds of licenses and many different products. And 70% of those companies say they will target Linux, or they do target Linux already. So there is, if you think about the success of Linux or the free desktop as a desktop platform, there is many also commercial applications written for it and coming to the platform. Now, most of those things is not retail software. So you must not be mistaken if you think like, is there any software for this? There's maybe, you know, some Adobe stuff, Acrobat Reader, there's very few things that you can get on Linux. There's a lot of other places where software is written and sold, complex software that runs on Linux that you never hear about. So it is a pretty strong platform. So, we have a lot of development going on, lots of users. You can use a Linux computer with a free desktop. Everything's relatively consistent. Is the mission accomplished? Is the free desktop basically finished? All remains is a little bit of polishing here and there, and that's it. Of course, that's a boring rhetorical question. No way. In my view, the journey just began. In the past 9 years, we've developed from basically nothing to a usable desktop system for everybody. In fact, it's so usable, it has so many features, that many of you probably don't use it because it has too many features and you don't need them. But there's numerous challenges in front of us which give us even more opportunities. Once you reach the line of necessary features, you have a foundation from where you can go on and innovate. The free desktop is there, it is usable, people can use it. Now we have the opportunity to use this feature-complete, flexible framework and innovate and try new things. If you have ideas on how people should interact with the computer, how people should use the computer, you have two ways of doing it. You can make some research project, play around with, say, some 3D interfaces, new concepts of accessing files, etc. In a purely research prototype kind of way. That's fine. Lots of people have been doing it and have been doing that for many years. The transfer of those ideas into the mainstream, or you can choose to use KDE as a basis for this kind of work, join the KDE project and innovate with this existing flexible framework that is there. So I think we'll have exciting times in front of us if that's going to happen. I think it is going to happen. So let me talk about the challenges that we have in front of us. And we, I mean the mostly the KDE project. This is immediate challenge. Exciting place to be, and there's a lot of exciting stuff to do, no matter what kind of engineer you are. If you like low-level stuff, high-level stuff, if you like middleware type of programming, optimization type of programming, whatever, there's a lot of things going on. One of the important projects currently is Debussing and HAL. That is something we're going to integrate into KE. I don't know if you're familiar with Debussing. It's essentially a message-driven middleware, very similar to KE's DCAP. In many ways, it's a DCAP 2 kind of implementation. We've been involved in that from the start. The implementation was mostly done by Source Code Factory and about 7 people. And it has a chance of becoming a ubiquitously accepted middleware on the free desktop. Now, what does that mean and why is that important? We have seen what DCAP has done to the KE desktop when we introduced it in 1998-99. If you have the possibility that suddenly an application is not just a process, but you have the possibility to talk to every other application that there is, this creates a dynamic that allows you to integrate components and applications in a very smart way. The problem so far has been that this integration always starts at the border of the desktop world. That means KE applications could talk, GNOME applications couldn't talk, separate applications couldn't talk to that world. So while we had C bindings and tried to promote it, sort of, nobody really picked it up. Debus has the chance of becoming that middleware that everybody's using. By introducing Debus, nothing will change the first year. What happens the next year and the year after is interesting, because once you have a standard way for any application to talk to any other application, you suddenly can start to cooperate on a higher level. You can start agreeing on interfaces for all sorts of things. Currently, we would like to cooperate more with the GNOME people, and they would like to cooperate more with us or another involved desktop groups. The problem is, how do you define your interfaces? How do you make that happen in terms of technology? Debus is that technology. So I think you will see a lot of cooperation and integration evolving from the introduction of. And by the way, that's not the first time the projects are doing this. We have a lot of free desktop standards that were written in an effort, sometimes more KE guys, sometimes more GNOME guys, but we did that together, like XDND, XMBAD, or the extended window managing with the specification. So one challenge for KE is to get more involved in free desktop support. In fact, I think the whole desktop community should get more involved in free desktop support. The other challenge is to get more involved in X.org. If you followed the desktop in the past years, there was one stable thing that you can't touch, that you can't change, that you just have to live with, and that you could rely on, and that was X. And a lot of people in the community still have that mindset. X is how X is, and X is there. But that has changed. X has reorganized itself. Now we have X.org. It's an open development process, and everybody is invited to go there. And some people start going there and innovating around X. If you're interested in graphics and image manipulation and cool things, have a look at the X project. They're desperate trying to get people, and this is where you can have a make a significant difference. So getting involved in X.org is a challenge for KE. Next one is we have to port from Q3 to Q4 and kind of refactor the framework. And the last one is we have the possibility to have KDE applications on Windows. When the Qt becomes GPL on Windows, the question is, are we going to do that? Who is going to do that? Who wants to support it? Is that something the community wants as well? Here's some strategic key focus areas the project's working on. One focus area is, of course, groupware. Contact is our client, CodeHub is a server, but again, in a way, work as a functional replacement to the Exchange server. The project hasn't quite the mindset that groupwise and evolution others have, but if you're interested in groupware, check it out in terms of features, it is definitely not behind. Software development is extremely important to KDE. KDevelop has to be mentioned here as probably the most advanced free IDE, especially if you consider C++ support. Eclipse at that point in time cannot mention at all. And of course there's Qt 4 as a software development tool to simplify the development process. Accessibility is a key focus area for all of the free dev community. It's one for many reasons. One reason, of course, is accessibility is important for people that depend and that rely on assistive technologies. The second thing is accessibility is important because it is a way, an area where we in the free desktop world actually can be a lot better than anything else that exists out there. And with the support that accessibility gets in terms of government requirements, this can actually be a major benefit for free software. Or the other way around, if we don't do it, we probably can easily get kicked out of getting into contracts. The last focus area is beyond hierarchical data. The desktop as a searchable web of context. This is quoted from a talk that Scott Wheeler will give after my presentation in the other room. This is about, well, desktop search and metadata. We all are confused that it's easier to find information on the internet than it is to find information on the local hard drive, and that's going to change. And that will be. We do have a lot of ideas how this is going to change. Technical challenges. The thing that annoys me the most is during startup time. And you've seen that when I was booting. First, the SUSE distribution was booting like for almost 2 minutes. And then when I logged into KDE, it also took a significant amount of time before it was starting up. And why is that? This is not because we are all bad programmers, but because we program in kind of good style. Everything's very modular, it's independent processes, it's very dynamic, etc. Which works, and it's very nice and flexible, but of course it has an impact on startup time. So improving that, I think, is very important, because it's just getting longer. Multimedia framework is another major challenge, where the free desktop is not settled, where we need a common ground. Usability. There's a lot of discussion currently going on in the community about usability. Who's using the computer? Who's using the desktop? Who's the target user? And how should we address all those things? This is some of my personal thoughts. There are a lot of other thoughts. Some do agree, some people might not agree. It just shows that we have a lot of freedom now to innovate and find new things. For example, we follow the approach of a universal browser. The file manager is a web browser. And that is basically because the KIO slave architecture was very successful. You can map anything to an IO slave. The question is that the right thing to do? Or is it easier for the user of your image manipulation program, your image database, your web browser, or your file manager, or your MP3 collection thingy are actually distinct applications rather than users and browser. So there's lots of things going on. do suffer from a significant amount of feature and configuration bloat and tool bomb clutter. The problem with this is, very often you have discussions like where people say, this, but nobody uses, why can't we just remove it? Well, every feature you have in a piece of software is there for a reason. Because somebody requested it, and somebody cared enough about the feature to implement it. So it's very, very difficult to remove volunteering work that people have done or hide it away. Although you eventually understand that you have to because it's simply too much. There is like an acid test, but when a GUI is too complex, is when you notice that users no longer use the toolbars or the menus, but they only work with the context menu because that's the only thing that kind of narrows down the options that you have at any given point in time. So one of the challenges we have is simplification of the user experience. There are a couple of broken concepts in KDE that I think should be fixed. One of it is, that's my personal opinion, is magic sidebars. Conqueror has a very advanced sidebar that does all sorts of things. I haven't yet found a user who's actually using that. So I'm still, whenever I meet a KDE developer, I ask, do you use the sidebar? I always get, I don't. So if you're using the sidebar, come to me after the talk. The other broken concept is something I feel guilty of. It's copied from Microsoft Windows. I implemented it not because I liked it, but because there was a user request and lots of people asked for it. That is system tray. The system tray is the little area here at the bottom with lots of small icons. And that's a standard setup. I haven't configured anything, and I now have six icons already in there. And the more software people install, the more icons you get. Like on Microsoft Windows, it's pretty extreme. Most people that configure the computer, like the graphics card or any network, anything, they spend most of the time trying to fiddle around here with those little icons popping up in the windows. And it's very hard to do with a laptop mouse. You have this huge screen, and you're basically filling in that little corner. This is the most important corner you have. So it's just a broken concept, and we have to do something about it. We have challenges with the programming framework. I focus on the second part. We do have language bindings. Like today or yesterday, there was a talk about KDE programming with Python. We do have Ruby bindings. There's like, if you can develop certain plugins written in Ruby, there's people writing software with Java bindings. There has been a project to chart that was used with a portable .NET. And there's all sorts of layers. But if you look at the result, very few people write software in those higher level abstractions. They all stick to C++. It might be interesting to figure out why that is. Is it the quality of the bindings that's promoted? What is the reason for that? And you can see something similar in the GNOME world, even though C is maybe a bit harder to use, most people still go the C way instead of using any of the bindings for the application that you go to C and have as part of the distribution. We do have some social challenges in any big project. I think the project has become very big, which requires some effective project leadership, which currently works fine and self-organized, but it's a little bit non-transparent. We heard that it's sometimes a bit difficult to enter the KDE community and understand how it works, to know who to talk to, etc. So in any project of a certain size, you always have to ask yourself the question, how do we make decisions? How do we make sure that maybe we have some meritocracy? During the Wikipedia talk, we talked about aristocracy, and we have some elements of that, but you don't want to have like If you look at the computers we had in 1996, the standard computers, and the ones we have now in 2005, a couple of things changed significantly. The CPUs went from average 33 megahertz to like 3 gigahertz, which is a factor of 90. We have 90 times the CPU. I'm talking desktop computers. We have average was back then, I think, 8 megabyte. Now the average is 512, maybe even more, which is a factor of 64. We have 64 times the RAM. The most important growth was the hard disk. We had like 100 megabyte in 96. Now we have 100 gigabyte, which is a factor by 1,000. The network improved from like 38 kilobit to a megabit, which is affected by 26. But what is more important, we have like the broadband networks that we have are like round the clock. It's no longer dialogue. You have a network all the time. The stream changed from roughly 800, 600 to twice the resolution, but not just twice the resolution. It's also almost twice the dots per inch. We had like 75 dpi back then. Today, I don't know, it's come like 135, maybe 140. And the uses of our software, the uses of the free desktop, easily went up from a few hundred to 100,000, maybe millions, I don't know how they work out. At least a factor of 1,000. And that means the world changed drastically, and one should think that these kind of changes, especially the changes on this storage side, have an impact on how we do computing. So let's see what we've done with that in a cynical view. We have 90 times the CPU, that means we do a bit more eye candy and we search for extraterrestrial life. 64 megabytes, 64 times the RAM, that allows us to do sloppy programming and not care anymore. 1,000 times the hard disk, that's great, a lot of space to store MP3s. And 26 times the network, I mean, we need to get the MP3s from somewhere. So what do we do with a larger screen? We have larger fonts. I put more items on the system tray. And to address our big user base, we just add more configuration options to make them all happen. Of course, that is a cynical view, but I still think it's quite remarkable how little change after the computers changed so drastically. Realistically, things are not quite as black. We have 90 times the CPU, and if you look at the modern desktop, there's a lot of background tasks and things going on that make use of a fast CPU. I give you an example that we didn't have back then. We do have spell checking everywhere. You fill out a form in a web page, you write a mail, you write a little note, everything's spell checked in background, very non-intrusive, little red line, you understand here, easy. Happens all the time, you couldn't do that 10 years ago. We have auto-completion, whenever you type in open office, you can see that how the work is completed. If you do a programming editor, we don't just do primitive syntax highlighting based on token. We do a class parse. We parse the whole logic. We compile it in the background and understand what you're writing in order to give you feedback. KDevelop is doing that intensively. We have functionality like search while typing. And we use a lot of CPU and stuff like scripting and extremely modular programming. So I think we're doing quite well on the CPU side. The network is probably the area that is used best. We have, thanks to the broader network, web applications, contents, heavy web applications like Wikipedia. We read our email with IMAP. We install and update our computer systems through the network. Some people probably boot through the network. We also do things like KDevelop Assistant does that. That you don't install anything locally, but some parts of the documentation you would just access online. And we would hide that from the user. You just know some documentation comes online, some is not installed. That works fine because we have a fast network and we have it all the time. and of course RSS feeds and all kinds of services. But what should we do? Now, what are the possibilities we have with native proxies? We could do a lot more, obviously, for many standard tasks that a user is doing on the desktop, writing email, web browsing. The computer has a lot of extra time. So we can do with multi-threading and stuff in background, we can do a lot of things, a lot of background computation, like indexing, looking up, looking ahead, trying to figure out what the user may want to do, and prepare that kind of information for RAM, we just want to save. It's always a problem. Hard disk is the most remarkable for if you drop the MP3 collection, we have more hard disks. We basically have unlimited hard disk space, unless you do video editing. But for what you can create, office-type documents, even the emails you can write, we have unlimited storage. And still today, we require a user to save documents. And when you forget saving your documents, you might have an autosave copy or not. And when you saved it, your old version is lost. One of the biggest differences in terms of using a computer between a geek and ordinary people is that we use revision control systems for everything. Everything I do is in someone who affords a CVS as a version. And we are used to that, but we don't offer it to the normal user. Everybody has hard disk that's big enough that when you write a PhD thesis, a master's thesis, whatever, or even letters, we can store all revisions. Easily, enough space, go back in time when you made a mistake. We also have a lot of space in order to do replication caching when being occasionally disconnected. This is something we don't use a lot. The question is, if we think ahead 2 years from now, will we have like insanely huge hard disks and sometimes no network, or will we have network all the time, except in places where you really don't want network? If we think that wireless network will be available for us wherever we are, then we don't need to work with this replication and caching technologies. But maybe it will take longer for us to get there, and it's interesting to use these hard disks to take all the information cached with you that we normally use. One thing that everybody talks about and nobody really has a solution is the file system. We think that it has the size it has today, the amount of files it has today, the way you work with it, it has to die from using this computer. The last slide, the network. Today we have 26 times the network that we had before, and we have more time. This allows us to finally do things like technology that we wanted to do like in the 80s or early 90s. Today it works fine. With an external machine, you have possibilities that you didn't have before in order to use your desktop remotely wherever you are. And at this point in time, those technologies are not quite integrated in the desktop in everyday usage as they could be. And we could all have persistent sessions anywhere, go anywhere else, just go there and get access to our desktop. But this is not how we use computers today. We have twice the screen, and what we did was bigger fonts. And obviously, the natural step, what we should do, is resolution and DPI in the middle. Because we also have embedded devices. They have screens like that. And on very small LCDs, you get a very high number of dots per inch. Like, I think up to 200, it's like paper. So if you write applications that should work on a screen like this with 200 DPIs, or on a screen like this with 140 DPIs, you need to eventually get to vector graphics, resolution, and DPI independent drawing. In Q4, all the drawing we will do is totally float-based and anti-aliased, so we have a lot of possibilities to make that screen independent. Really last slide, I promise. With 1,000 times at least the interface. That means we are moving from underground culture to mainstream. Computers are no longer geek toys. Computers are part of everyday culture. In the old days, we made fun of like how we grandma used that computer, and we knew like grandma would use that computer, so it didn't matter. But today, grandma uses the computer. And what's worse is, eventually we become grandparents too. And the older you get, and I'm not that old, but I still can feel it with myself, the less you're interested in doing complicated things with your computer. After you install Linux like 50 times, you just want it to work out of the box. So we have to think about where we want to be. We are no longer just a subculture. So the free desktop revolution just began. And if you think you want to make a difference on the desktop, now is the perfect time to join the KDE project or any other free desktop project. And the good thing about that sentence is it was true last year and will probably also be true next year. Thank you for your attention.